Say hello to friends you know and everyone you meet. Ho, ho, the mistletoe hung where you can see. Somebody waits for you, kiss her once for me. Have a homely, jolly Christmas, and in case you didn't hear, oh, by golly, have a holly, jolly Christmas this year.
Have a holly, jolly Christmas, it's the best time of the year.
Everyone you meet. Ho, ho, the mistletoe hung where you can see. Somebody waits for you, yes sir, once for me. Have a homely, jolly Christmas, and in case you don't hear, oh, by golly, have a holly, jolly Christmas this year.
Let us pray.
Every Sunday morning at 9 o'clock on KCWM, be listening for the Victory Baptist Church program with its pastor, Mark Bauman. Now, here's Pastor Bauman.
Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to the radio broadcast of the Victory Baptist Church of Hondo, Texas. I'm Brother Mark Bauman, and as the announcer has already told you, and so you've been forewarned, if you're going to be with us now for the next half hour, you're going to have to listen to me, but Lord willing, I'll be a blessing to you. That's what I do, is to bless to you. Third of God, we sing in the name that is above every name, the name of Jesus Christ. Why, some people leave his name out of Christmas and they X him out. Some people use his name for we believe there is the honor in the name of God, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. One man, Jesus, he was crying, is the Christ, anointed God, the Messiah. And to you, my friend, I hope and pray that he is both Lord and Savior, and also your coming King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The Bible says that someday every knee will bow, and every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. It's funny, this time of year, there's a lot of pushing for the Christmas holidays. And of course, you've heard the holiday music on here before we come on. And I tell you, if you know the Lord Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you're going to stay out of hell, we're going to preach that in a minute, I guess you can have a holly jolly Christmas. But the things that are more important than that is to know that they're trying to make you believe in Santa Claus and make you believe in some things, you know, for the little kids. Do you believe in Jesus Christ? All things, the Bible talks about belief. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and thou shalt be saved. Friend, what do you believe this morning? Do you believe in Jesus Christ? Do you think of him as your Savior? Or do you think he was just some Jewish man that walked the earth 2 millennia ago? It really has no bearing on modern day society. I tell you, friend, if you don't think that Jesus has any bearing on society, then I don't know how you would ever spend any time watching basketball. Because the people that you watch on the basketball games and the football games, your children won't even know who you're talking about. If you think that Jesus Christ has no bearing on modern society, I don't know why you watch movies. Because the people that are popular, the movie stars out in Hollywood right now, when your kids and grandkids come along and you're talking about the people you watched on the screen at this moment or on television or your favorite show, they're going to laugh at you. They won't have a clue what you're saying. But for 2,000 years, the world has had the name of God's Son, Jesus Christ, preached to them, the gospel, by his death, burial, and resurrection. And friend, today, if you've heard that gospel and you think it has no bearing on your life, you believe that at your peril of your eternal soul. You can go sit in a movie theater and shed a tear over some Hollywood romance. By the way, you're shedding real tears. The tears in their eyes are made from glycerin. But regardless of all that, you can believe what you want and have your emotions and your mentality swayed by the world. But the Bible tells you, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and be saved. You may think that Santa's real. You may think he's fake. You may think that Harry Potter's real. You may think it's fake. I don't know what you think this morning. But if you don't think that Jesus, which is called Christ, came to save you, friend, I don't know what your ignorance level is for. Ignorance is bliss, they used to say. But I say to you, ignorance is not bliss when it comes to the law or the Lord. If Jesus Christ is not the Son of God and God the Son, come down from heaven, born as a baby in a little manger to save this old, lost, sin-cursed world, then he was the greatest blasphemer that has ever walked this earth. Jesus said, I do all things that please the Father. He said, I'm come that you might have life. He said, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save that which was lost. And if you believe that you have life today, and you believe that you please God, and you believe that you are saved, but you don't believe in Jesus Christ, friend, you are the greatest blasphemer who has ever lived. You cannot get away by meeting God without first meeting his Son, the Lord Jesus Christ, as your Savior. We say all that because our main push is not church attendance. I don't care how big or how small our church is. It will be exactly what God intends it to be, and may it ever be so. We're not interested in your money. I don't care if you put in $5 in the plate. I don't care if you put in $5 million in the plate. It makes no difference to this preacher. God has blessed me in so many ways that I care not for those stupid things. I don't need a new plane. I don't have an old one, by the way, in case you wonder. But I don't need a new plane to expand our ministry around the world where we don't have to fret with commercial airlines for the ministry's sake, or some stupidity that you hear from the average preacher on television and radio. I care about your soul. I got up this morning and got out of my bed at 4:30 a.m. and it was about 25 degrees up at the house where I live, and began to pray and seek God's will for what I would preach to you today. And God has made it very clear. But I pray that if you have not come to the acknowledgement of your sin, radio friend, that you would do that. Stop trying to be religious. Stop trying to work your way to heaven. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, that baby born in a manger, born to die, that you might have eternal life. If Jesus Christ is not who he said he was, then he was a whack job. He said, I am come that you might have life. I am come, the Son of Man has come to seek and to save. Listen, if he's not the bread of life in your life, then who is? If he's not the door and the way and the truth in your life, then who is? If he's not your chief shepherd and the Lamb of God come to take away your personal sin, then who do you claim to take away your sins this morning? Yourself? Your good old grandma? Or your dear sweet mama? Is she going to do it for you? Are they going to do it for you? What about your wonderful father, the man that loved you, that raised you? What about your grandpa, the person that took a lot of trouble with you when you were a little brat, you know, and put up with you on the weekends so your parents wouldn't go insane and kill you? What about those people? Can they save you? Absolutely not. Why, there was a man, the Bible says, who was a man of sorrows, who bore our sins. Why, if no one grieved for your sin and bore your sins in their own body, if it's not Jesus Christ, then who is it? Why, the Bible even calls Christ the judge of the quick and the dead. You've seen the movie, you know, you've heard about the quick and the dead. You say, well, I think that's about somebody who's fast. No, quick means alive, and dead means dead. By the way, if you aren't that smart, the opposite of dead is alive. So if you use common third grade common sense, you can figure it out. But how in the world are you going to have somebody who can judge people that are alive and dead unless you know someone who was dead and is now alive? If that isn't Jesus Christ in your life, pray tell, friend, who is it? You need the Bible to tell you. The Word of God is quick and powerful. The Word of God tells you where you're coming from, what you're supposed to do while you're here, and where you're going to go when you die. And it is the Word of God that we turn to this morning for the authority of our message to you today on the literal reality, again, once more, of a place called hell. Why, the modern theologians have taken the fire extinguisher of some seminary somewhere and tried to water down the grim reality that there is a place, it's an awful place, of weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth, according to the Bible. The Bible speaks of hell as a place where there is torment, but the worm dies not, and the fire is not quenched. You say, well, preacher, how is that possible? The Bible says over there in Mark 9, 44, 46, and 48. By the way, you can know that you have a phony Bible or a worthless Bible if either Mark 9, 44, 46, or 48 is taken out of the book. Three times the same verse warns you that hell is a place of torment where the worm dies not. You see, I've had some worms on my cabbage plants, and we've been spraying them and all that kind of business, you know. You're using the organic stuff. You know, the BT, for those of you that know what I'm talking about, or listen to Bob Webster. And spraying that stuff for those worms to die, but they won't die. I hope and pray to God that every single one of those cabbage worms that's eating up your preacher's kale and collard greens and purple and green cabbage, I hope they all froze to death last night. I hope those worms are gone. Did you say, preacher, are there worms in hell? Right now inside of your body are dormant worms. Go ahead and read your biology book someday. And the Bible tells you that when you get to hell, you're not going to decompose or burn up. That those dormant worms inside of you that'll eat your body alive from the inside out when you die. You've heard the poem, the worms crawl in, the worms crawl out, the worms play pinochle on your snout. Friend, it's a serious thing that the Bible tells you that hell is a real place where people go and they do not die and they're tormented forever. You say, preacher, that sounds like an awful harsh reality for somebody. Listen, don't you tell me for one moment that if you were God and you sent your only child to die for somebody and they spit in his face, that you wouldn't do the same thing. Go ahead and tell me you've got all the grace in the world to forgive people for sinning against you if you were a high and holy and a sinless God. Go ahead and tell me that if you were God and you created you, and you treated God, you treated you the way you treat God if you were God. That may be a little confusing for some of you, but you get the idea. Go ahead and tell me that if you were on a throne and you could do or say whatever, and everything you did was holy and right and pure, that the way people treat you and talk about you, and the way the world itself has turned its back on you and spit in the face of your son, and he died and he hung on that cross for their sin, and still they have no desire to even have him as part of a holiday called Christmas. Go ahead and tell me if you were God that you wouldn't have some horrible judgment for a person like that. Why, some of you would try to think of something worse. You say, oh, preacher, it's Christmas season. You ought to water the thing down a little bit. Have a little grease. Have a little class. Have a little polish, preacher. You don't need to be one of those hellfire creatures, one of them old-timers. Listen, friend, it has nothing to do with what I think or believe or what you think or believe. It is what is found within the Word of God. And the very best gift that I could give you at this holiday season would not be for you to rock around your Christmas tree or for you to have some figgy pudding or something like that. The greatest thing that could ever happen to you at this holiday season of the year is to get holy on this day or any day that you so desire and believe on Jesus Christ as your Savior. You see, Jesus Christ came to save you. But he didn't just come to make you a wonderful person and, you know, to make you a fit for modern society or to enlighten you or inspire your soul or put you in the mood to be a better person. Jesus Christ came to die that you wouldn't have to go to this awful, awful place called hell. By the way, if you don't think that hell is a fitting message for the month of December and for the happy holiday season, then go outside when it's 25 or 30 degrees, and you know what you'll do? You'll go straight to a fire. But you know what? If you were standing in the middle of that fire, you know what you'd do? You'd try to get out of it for all you're worth. And friend, that's what we're trying to help you to do today. If you can feel the fires of hell and you have not trusted Jesus as your Savior, and you are that one out there in this audience that is nearest hell, I pray today you'll realize that it's a reality and believe on Jesus Christ and accept that marvelous gift, that unspeakable gift that Paul wrote about. That's the gift of the knowledge that your sins are all covered under the blood of Calvary's cross and that Jesus Christ is your eternal Savior. Friend, if you're saved today and you have no need of the gospel message of a place called hell, may I remind you that someone else that you know does. Years ago, as you're turning to Luke chapter number 16 in your Bible, years ago I remember a commercial on television back when I had a TV. I got to the point where I didn't have any money and I didn't have any desire for somebody to sell me something every 10 minutes. Try to peddle some garbage that I, you know, didn't really need. And I thought that a lot of the stuff that was on TV was not anywhere near as clever as it was 20 years before. So we took the television and disconnected it. But years ago, when I had a television in my house, they used to have an anti-smoking commercial. And they went around with little, cigarettes over somebody's head, or it was lung cancer or something like that. And it was like a crowded street in New York, you know. And it says, see all of these symbols over everyone's head? Each of these symbols indicates one out of nine or whatever Americans, one out of every 10 Americans, whatever the stats were, that's going to die of lung cancer from cigarette smoke. And I thought, well, I guess if you could see something like that in reality, that it might make you sober up and put your cigarettes down. But you know what I think is even worse than that? If you could go out in the holiday hustle and bustle and go to the malls and the stores and the shops, and Christian, if you're really a Christian and you really do care about souls like your Savior, Christ, did. By the way, being a Christian doesn't just mean you go to church on Sunday. Christ came to see people saved. And Christian, if you're not doing something to see somebody saved, you can hardly call yourself a Christian. Don't get mad at me. Kick yourself around the block. But if you go out in the malls and you look at the people out there and you could see little tongues of fire over the head, like that commercial of old, over the head of people that are on their way to hell, and you could walk by that person knowing that if they died right then that they would go to hell, some of you might just have a little bit of time enjoying your Sunday dinner. And the truth of it is that everybody knows somebody that's got a good chance of them seeing eternity. Why, you say, friend, you might tell me, oh, Pastor, I got years to live. I got plenty of time. You have no idea what you've got in your future. The Bible says, boast not thyself of tomorrow. And yet some of you are boasting about what you're going to do the next year or 5 years or 10 years, or what your mutual funds or your money is going to bring you at such and such a time, and when you're going to retire. You're thinking like that when the Bible tells you not to brag about tomorrow? You got to be out of your cotton picking mind. Why, the Bible tells you that hell is a real place. And the fact is that if you're listening to me right now without Jesus, you might be on your way there before the sun goes down. Christ Jesus, the one we worship at this time of year, spoke more about hell than he did about heaven. If you don't believe me, have enough guts to prove me wrong, and read Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in your spare time. You might have to give up a little bit of your Google time, or your Facebook, or Instagram, or your chat time, or something like that, and read your Bible, and it'll do you good. But if you believe me wrong, go ahead and read it. Jesus spoke more about hell than he did about heaven. Why? Because he knew what was in man, and he knew that man likes to run from the truth. In fact, that's why he said, I am the truth. And the truth of it is, according to modern statistics, that 3/4 of the churches today don't even believe in a literal hell. Some churches will tell you that hell is the little problems that you have in life. You know, my old lady, she put me through hell. And you believe when you get up on Monday morning and your battery's weak, and you say, to hell with this, and you get all frustrated. Oh, friend, we've all been there. But that is just the problems of life. That is not hell. You say, preacher, I think most people believe in hell. Then you think wrong. I have an article from a Signs of the Times magazine dated April 2017 right here, page number 62, where somebody wrote into that Seventh-day Adventist magazine, I think it is, and asked them, if people die, where do they go if they're not saved and they disobey God? And it says right here in the article, hell is not going on now, so wicked people cannot be sent to a hell that doesn't exist. The hell only exists in the end of the world in Revelation 20. Let me tell you, when Jesus Christ gave what we're about to read here, this was 2,000 years ago, and regardless of what the magazine in front of me, or what your thoughts, or what you've heard, hell is going on now, and has been going on for some long time. The Bible says in Luke 16 and verse 19, there was a certain rich man which was clothed in purple and fine linen, and fared sumptuously every day. And there was a certain beggar named Lazarus, which was laid at his gate full of sores, and desiring to be fed with the crumbs which fell from the rich man's table. Moreover, the dogs came and licked his sores. And it came to pass that the beggar died. Sometimes as a preacher begging people to serve the Lord, sometimes I think that'd be a good headstone for me. And the beggar died, put it on my grave tomb or something. And the beggar died and was carried by the angels into Abraham's bosom. The rich man also died and was buried, and in hell. You say, well, preacher, my Bible says Hades. You can call it Hades. You can call it Sheol. You can call it the place of the dearly departed spirits. You can call it Gehenna. You call it whatever you want to, but Jesus Christ and the Bible says that man died and he went to hell. Call it whatever you want to call it, but the Bible says that it's a bad place. The scriptures here tell us that he lifted up his eyes and he was in torments. It doesn't matter what you call the thing, it's a place of torment. And seeth Abraham afar off, and Lazarus in his bosom, verse 24, and he cried and said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me, and send Lazarus. You know what people in hell want? You say, well, the rich man here, he wanted some water. Yeah, but you know what he asked for before he asked for water? He asked for mercy. Radio friend, get that through your skull this morning, that the very moment you're in torment, all you can think about is how you would like some mercy. And today, right now as you listen to me, God in His grace and in His mercy is reaching out to you. So if you ever wake up in hell someday and you desire the mercy of God, remember, I call heaven and earth to testify against it today. Remember, right now is the accepted time. Now is the day. God's mercy is free for the taking. It's on the table if you want it. But someday God's mercy will be revoked. And if you deny God's mercy and God's grace and God's love through Jesus Christ, then all you'll see of God for the rest of your born days and the rest of the days after you die will be nothing but judgment and torment and weeping and wailing. Don't get mad at me, friend. Kick yourself around the block. If that's the facts of your life, why don't you change your future? Why don't you change your destiny? Why don't you restructure your family tree right now and be saved? Repent of your sins. Ask Jesus Christ. I'm not talking about religion or coming to church or joining some cult or some group or praying through or seeing any lights. I'm talking about repenting of your sin and believing in Jesus as your Savior. Why don't you do that right now while His mercy is there? But he said, Father Abraham, have mercy on me. Send Lazarus that he may dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue, for I am tormented in this flame. You say, well, that's not hell. That's Gehenna. That's Sheol. Torment and flame, you call it what you want to, is not a good thing any day of the week in any place. Abraham said, Son, remember that thou in thy lifetime receivest good things, and likewise Lazarus evil things, but now he is comforted, and thou art tormented. And beside all this, between us and you, watch it, there is a great gulf fixed. Why, I couldn't care less if today's preacher uses the fire extinguisher of his theology to water down hell. It's a real place where real people are being tormented right now, and they couldn't get out for all their worth. The Bible says the people that are there cannot pass, and they that pass to us that would come from thence. And he said, Father Abraham, send somebody to my father's house, for I've got five brethren, that he may testify unto them, lest they also come into this place of torment. Abraham said unto him, they have Moses and the prophets, let them hear them. And he said, nay, Father Abraham, but if one went unto them from the dead, they will repent. You know what the guy wants to do? He wants to get out of hell, no matter what it takes. And Abraham said, if they won't listen to Moses and the prophets, they won't listen if someone comes back from the grave. And friend, if you don't want what God has written to you today in the Old Testament and the New Testament, and you refuse to believe in a resurrected Savior, born to die, rose again, that you might have eternal life, you're hell bound, just as sure as your heart beats. In our text right here, you say, well, preacher, I'm looking for the Prince of Peace. That's what I'm looking for, too. But the devil would like to take someone away from the hands of the Prince of Peace and bring them down into a place called hell and drag them the way that all flesh goes. Hell is no respecter of persons. You'll notice the rich man, he could probably, friend, I don't know who you are or how much money you got, but I'd be willing to bet this rich man we're reading about right here could buy the shirt right off your back. And every person you've ever met, more than likely. When the Bible calls a rich man, he is a rich man. If you were to figure in all that Abraham owed and adjust it for gross inflation and all that, he could have bought Bill Gates and Andrew Carnegie and all the people that have been Warren Buffett. Abraham could have had them polish his shoes. He knew what rich really was. Not only that, but he also had God on top of it. But if you're a rich man today and own all this world and its treasures and its pleasures, and you die without Jesus Christ, you're poor folk. You're country bumpkins as far as spiritual matters are concerned. And if you're a country bumpkin today, just barely getting by, bless God, can barely pay your bills and keep food on the table, and you have Jesus Christ as your Savior, you're as rich as the day is long. You better thank God for that. The Bible says that hell is a no respecter of persons. It's appointed unto men once to die. And that rich man, poor man, beggar man, thief, it doesn't make any difference. If you die without Christ, you will be immediately in hell. By the way, friend, the man we're talking about here has been there for 2,000 years. And if I could pull him out of hell and let him preach it, he'd do a whole lot better job than I. Listen, if you're rich, if you're popular, if you're intellectual, if you're athletic, if you have culture coming out your ears, it is no substitute for Jesus Christ, because all who can be saved for eternity can also be lost for eternity. You have great potential today, friend. You will live eternally either in heaven or in hell. And you get to make the choice. How about that? Man doesn't have to commit murder to go to hell. All he has to do is to deny Jesus Christ as his Savior and his Lord. The Bible says, he that believeth not, didn't say he that killeth or he that maimeth or he that rapeth or he that stealeth. It says, he that believeth not is condemned already. Do you believe? If you don't believe, you're already condemned. I don't have to. Our church doesn't have to. The Bible doesn't have to. Hell's a literal place of fire. Do you tell me you want to go there? Why, come on, friend. And the Bible says if you ever get there, you can't get out. No candle flame, no Holy Mary candle will ever burn you out of some limbo or some purgatory or some man-made idea of hell. You cannot pass. You ought to read Revelation 20 and 21 right before you go to bed. Hell was made for the devils and his angels, not you. It is a horrible place for unbelieving people. And if you go to hell, you will go there, friend, over the broken, bleeding body of the Lord Jesus Christ, that babe born in a manger, to die that you don't have to go there. Today, my friend, if you don't know Jesus Christ as your Savior, this station has enough guts to broadcast the truth to you that man is indeed a sinner, He needs Jesus Christ and Christ alone to save. And whosoever will may have everlasting life. If you have it today, be glad you've got it. It's the very best thing that you'll ever have and possess. To be God's children and to be God's child and to be His possession is the greatest thing you'll ever possess. But if you know someone who is on their way to this awful, awful place, tell them about Jesus Christ, that they might have eternal life and have life more abundantly. It's a wonderful thing to be a Christian. Radio neighbor, it's a wonderful thing to be saved. It's a wonderful thing to know this blessed Jesus and to possess the eternal life that He gave. Good morning, and God bless you.
You've been listening to Mark Bonham, pastor of the Victory Baptist Church in Hondo. You are cordially invited to attend any of the services at Victory Baptist Church. Sunday Bible study for all ages at 10 a.m., followed by the 11 o'clock morning worship service and the evening service at 5 p.m. On Wednesdays, it's the church supper at 5:30 p.m. and midweek worship service at 6. Tune in next Sunday morning at 9 for the Victory Baptist Church program with Pastor Mark Bonham. Our mailing address is Victory Baptist Church, Post Office Box 839, Texas 78861.
From San Antonio to Uganda, from Texas, you're listening to AM 1460 KCWM Hondo, Texas.
Tall pines are humming, Christmas time to come.